Welcome, everybody. My name is Mark Bach, and my wife Kathy and I shared the cul-de-sac with Dan and Laura for many years as our children went through the school systems and on through college. But today is dedicated to Laura and everything that she meant to us. And that is a lot. It's fitting that we've returned to this community where she raised her sons and gardened and jogged and danced and sang and practiced her profession of helping those in need. Some have come here from great distances to honor her, whether family or childhood friends, neighbors, and fellow travelers. We have a chance to share together what she meant to us. Our commonality is that we all loved and admired her. And she returned that love many times over. So we belong to her clan today, Laura's clan. And we have stories to tell. And as we hear them, we may be surprised to learn new things about her, because such was the richness and breadth of her amazing life. Her story begins when she was born Laura Gail Funk on September 16, 1958, in Arlington Heights, Illinois. The fourth child of Arthur and Phyllis Funk. When Laura was five, the family moved from Arlington Heights to a home that Art had designed in a small subdivision in the Lake Park Estates in Palatine, Illinois. Laura was the only girl in her family, but there were girlfriends nearby, and Laura made a special bond with her friend Caroline. There was a little lake, and there was a home for ducks in the summer and kids skating in the winter. There were woods to play in and big weeping willows where Laura climbed when solitude was needed. In the muggy Midwest summers, the above-ground pool in Laura's backyard provided fun and cool relief from the heat. Laura went to elementary school and junior high in Sanborn School, where she was able to take French classes starting in third grade. Laura's years from age 11 rather to 16 were a time of great turbulence for her and her two brothers. The family changed forms, moved multiple times. Laura's mother moved out of state, and unexpectedly, she died when Laura was 15. Art managed to establish new stability for the family when Laura was 16. They moved into a townhouse in Rolling Meadows, and Art's girlfriend and eventual wife, Pat, brought much-needed mothering to the family. Laura attended William Fremd High School in Palatine, and since the third grade, had taken French classes, and Art promised her that if she stuck it out through high school, he would help her with a trip to Europe. They both kept that bargain, and the summer after high school, Laura and her friend Jean traveled by rail in Europe for 4 weeks. During her senior year in high school, Laura met her future husband, Dan. They started dating 2 days after graduation. They were very much in love, but left for college in the fall and were soon defeated by the 1,000-mile distance between their schools. Laura knew back in high school that she wanted to major in psychology and to become a family therapist. At Eastern Illinois University, she pursued her degree unwaveringly and excelled, financing her way with work-study jobs in the psychology department, and also participating in student government. Laura roomed throughout college with her dear friend, Sandy Blacker Spencer. They were committed to each other and to having a great time, which was a balancing act for Laura because she was simultaneously the student body vice president and on probation for huge... Yes, that's our party girl. For holding huge parties that she and Sandy were throwing in their in-campus apartment. She also loved athletics. She played tennis, flag football, and she began a lifelong love for running. When Laura was a senior at Eastern, Dan transferred to the University of Illinois in Urbana, just an hour away from Laura's school in Charleston. Their romance was famously reignited when Dan convinced Laura to drive with him to Mardi Gras in New Orleans in 1980. Then Dan and Laura were married in Long Grove, Illinois on January 2nd, 1982. Honeymooned in Spain and Morocco, and then headed for Long Beach, California. Laura had earned her bachelor's degree in psychology from Eastern Illinois University, and then followed up with a master's degree in psychology from Cal State. After the birth of Nicholas Dillon in 1984, Dan and Laura had had their fill of sunny LA, and they moved to the Seattle area, where they happily remained, and Skylar was born then in 1988. Laura's passion in life from the earliest age was towards healing and connection. She established herself as a marriage and family therapist in the early 1990s and helped many, many individuals, couples, and families through their most difficult times. She managed to make better and brighter the lives of everyone she touched, whether it was in the privacy of her office or out in the world laughing and living with family and friends. For 23 years, Laura and Dan lived in their Woodinville home where they raised their two wonderful sons. And they were just making their big downsizing move to the Queen Anne Hill neighborhood of Seattle when Laura fell ill with cancer. Even while she was increasingly restricted, Dan and Laura enjoyed city life to the fullest. Laura survived by her husband, Daniel Borman, of 34 years, her two sons, Nicholas Dillon and Skylar, her father, Arthur Funk, her brothers, Alan, Jeff, Michael, and Paul Funk, and her devoted mother-in-law, Jean Morris of Seattle. As was her wish, the Great Pacific Ocean is the eternal home of Laura's remains. The urn that contained her ashes will be interred at the Mount Pleasant Cemetery on Queen Anne Hill in Seattle. Laura had mixed feelings about her name. And sometimes as a young girl in school, she was teased about it. But as an adult, Laura finally embraced her funky last name. And back in 1975, NPR made an attempt to define the word funk. And Laura enjoyed it immensely when Dan brought this tape home on her birthday.
This is All Things Considered. I'm Robert Siegel.
And I'm Noah Adams.
Tether walk, we're gonna tether walk the mother sucker, tether walk the sucker. A tether walk, we're gonna tether walk the mother sucker, tether walk the sucker. A tether walk, we're gonna tether.
This music is to set the stage for a little discussion of the word of the week, funk. That's what the music's called, funk.
On Friday, President Clinton spoke to reporters traveling with him in California. He said his presidency has bogged down in details and that he, the president, must concentrate on the bigger picture. President Clinton said he should work harder to get people out of their funk. Then yesterday, Mr. Clinton broke with that earlier position and said he's decided that funk was a poor choice of words.
In conversations with reporters at the White House, the president also provided some fine points of funk. A funk, he said, is something you can bounce right out of. The funk, we discovered, has several meanings.
The dictionary indicates that funk comes from a Dutch word meaning a spark. That archaic meaning, most likely, is not the definition President Clinton intended when characterizing the people's mood in this country, but a meaning that first shows up in 1892 in a British publication in the sentence, "The gaffers in a fine funk," seems closest to the president's usage. The sense of ill humor in a surly state, a depressed mood, may be the short-lived Clinton analysis of this nation's psychological state.
But we went to another Clinton for a definition of funk, the man whose music we've been listening to, the king of funk, George Clinton.
What I think funk is whatever need to be for survival. I mean, I start by saying that, and it changed meanings every now and then, you know, for me. This particular time, I think it's what we call the awesome power of a fully operational mothership. And right about now, I think the word funk needs to be said.
The king of funk, George Clinton.
So it's a day of funk. That's a fact. And now we will hear some poetry selections. They're going to be read now by Dylan's partner, Kelly, and Dan and Laura's niece, Maddie.
Then the breakers turning back to brightness, if the light's opaque, ocean blue sameness in the sky can be said to break. The way the waves themselves, blue in back of blue, like a color in the eye, fall back to the wall, sea rack, driftwood, or the inner optic shelf behind the lens. Then the gulls and simple cirrus strands turn back to light, then to inland sparrows drifting under blue Seattle sky. It's a work day, and the heat is the heat of the color of your clothes, wash day, and hands hurt from the swinging of a scythe. Then it's day into night, at the heart of the seeds that fell from your hands breaking open, strewn in rows like water, along the ancient seabed floor of the farm. Someone is standing at the door. Someone is waving from the car. This day and that one, sinking to brightness and the blue evening wall before that, and the seed that fell from a star, becoming, as you will say, one day, all we will become.
Look, the trees are turning their own bodies into pillars of light, are giving off the rich fragrance of cinnamon and fulfillment. The long tapers of cattails are bursting and floating away over the blue shoulders of the ponds. And every pond, no matter what its name is nameless now. Every year, everything I have ever learned in my lifetime leads back to this. The fires and the black river of loss whose other side is salvation, whose meaning none of us will ever know. To live in this world, you must be able to do three things: to love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones knowing your own life depends on it, and when the time comes to let it go, to let it go.
Love is more thicker than forget, more thinner than recall, more seldom than a wave is wet, more frequent than to fail. It is most mad and moonly, and less it shall unbe than all the sea which only is deeper than the sea. Love is less always than to win, less is less never than alive, less bigger than the least begin, less littler than forgive. It is most sane and sunly, and more, it cannot die, than all the sky which only is higher than the sky.
Several people who knew Laura well are now sharing their remembrances of her with us. And that includes her father. Laura's father, Art Funk, is 92 years old, now living in Chicago, and was not able to travel to the service. I'll read some words that he sent with Laura's younger brother, Paul. Laura, I love you, and I always will. It's a tragic thing that has happened now for Dan and me and the rest of the family, and I guess that's the way the world is. We have to accept what happens, but Laura, I think of you often. And I always will. Farewell, Laura. I love you, Dad. Dan had planned to have his words read for him, but managed to record them himself. And so you will now be hearing Dan's tribute to Laura.
We each know a person in a different way. Many of you knew and loved Laura. You and she shared a unique relationship. I want to take a few minutes to tell you how I know Laura. It was January, the final semester of high school in Mr. Johnson's social studies class. I sat in the front row, and a cute girl named Laura Funk was sitting behind me, taking pleasure in slowly pushing my chair out in front of the class. Soon I noticed this girl was different than anyone I'd met. Besides being beautiful, funny, smart, athletic and adventurous. She seemed wise and in some ways serious beyond her 17 years. She had a firm and natural certainty in her experience of herself and the world that fascinated me. I needed to get close to her, understand, and maybe even absorb something she had. Later, she said that sitting behind me, she fell in love with my curly hair. I fell in love with her voice. Oh, Laura's voice. If you understand why Laura decided, even before I met her, that she would study psychology and become a family therapist, then you know something about what drove her. She was deeply and unshakably motivated by the idea of healing pain, repairing relationships, easing the struggles of families. I got to watch Laura work when I helped out at weekend workshops for couples. She was gentle, wise, and respectful. She never stopped learning new methods and skills, all to be more helpful to her clients. Laura's work was very rewarding to her, but it wasn't easy. She came home discouraged or disappointed in herself many times. Laura talked occasionally about making a job change. In retrospect, I think it was a theoretical conversation only. Laura needed to help her clients and would have kept doing it for a long time if life had allowed it. If Laura was committed to her therapy work, she was far more committed as a mom. Oh, how she loved her boys. They brought her so much pride and happiness, and she gave them so many gifts. Together they played and laughed, they cooked fun and delicious things in the kitchen from a young age. The kids absorbed her love and talent for music. Like her, they loved to read and learn. We traveled. Laura and the boys all spoke beautiful French. We sat down for dinner together. We talked through the tough issues, and we listened to each other. Laura modeled curiosity, fun, responsibility, emotional honesty, and respect. Those of you who know my sons will know that Laura succeeded as a mom. But Laura's mothering was not automatic or instinctive. She didn't trust her own childhood as a guide. She worked very hard with me to be the parent she wanted to be for her cherished sons. Let's talk about Laura's laugh. She loved to get silly, crack jokes, and laugh, laugh, laugh. I loved to listen to her laugh and laugh with her, but I'm a little challenged in that area. There were certain people in her life, and you know who you are, who she looked forward to being with because it was time to laugh. Laughing was one of the great joys and releases in Laura's life. I've talked about Laura as a professional and as a mother. Let's talk about this partnership we started 34 years ago. Laura's winning traits made for many happy days together. But I gradually figured out that this marriage was going to be more than having fun, raising our babies, and pursuing our careers. Laura was insisting on something else, and it was coming from a need deep inside her. In this marriage, Laura was not going to remain the radiant, but sometimes sad and distant young woman, and I was not going to remain the committed, but emotionally illiterate and limited young man. As I realized with considerable discomfort, this marriage was very much a journey of personal growth. I won't go into the details of how the sausage was made, so to speak. They're right when they say marriage involves hard work. Laura taught me to know myself, to discover my demons, face them, and resolve them, and to accept myself. She was on a parallel journey. Together, we perfected the art of listening to each other while sharing our deepest truths and respecting our different realities. We learned and healed and grew over the years and through our stages of life. I'm a better, happier, and more successful person for it. It's a special gift to have a best friend who knows you and loves you the way Laura knew and loved me. And I realize, with sadness, that I will not be known this well again. As our relationship strengthened, we were preparing, unknowing, for our final chapter together. I think we were ready, thanks to Laura, to navigate the 15 months of her illness in connection, with love, and with peace. Like a lot of things in Laura's life, she wouldn't have called marriage easy. She was wonderfully supportive of my passion to fly, though it took me away on many trips and over many weekends, and that was difficult for her. Parenting was a joy and difficult. While she helped heal the relationships in her office, she struggled in some relationships with family and friends. In many ways, Laura did not breeze through life. She worked at it. And I can tell you she always was giving the best she had. And at her core, what she wanted most was healing and connection. Laura was wonderfully complex, intelligent, funny, wise, accomplished, and determined. She was a dancer, singer, musician, athlete, gardener, chef, quilter, photographer, traveler, and an avid reader. I'm the lucky man to have Laura Funk as his life partner. She gave me so much, as she gave many of you. She's part of me now, and I will always have her with me. That cute, amazing 17-year-old that I had to get closer to. That stunning, warm, radiant woman. And that's what I wanted, to have her with me, in me, from the beginning.
I'm Carolyn Scholes, and Laura and I were neighbors and best friends as young girls in our hometown of Palatine. I know she made many more best friends throughout life, but she was mine back then. Laura Gail Funk was my first best friend. That's a pretty important thing I'll always treasure. My family moved into her neighborhood in 1966 when she and I were eight. Our mothers introduced us across the yards, and the next thing I knew, we were best friends and daily companions for about 5 years until her family moved away, and we just kind of grew apart. It wasn't until about 14 years ago that we reconnected as middle-aged women with husbands, kids, careers, and so many stories to catch up on, old and new. And we had an amazing and soulful reunion that rekindled a really beautiful and precious friendship from these formative years of our lives. We were outdoors kids. Unlike the next generation, it seems like we were out a lot. We were swimming in the pool that you talked about in these talks. We biked around a really cool neighborhood growing up. We ice skated on a pond that was across the street in this idyllic neighborhood in Palatine. We sledded down my family's front lawn, which was sloped. We played hopscotch, we jumped rope, we played on the swing set a lot in her yard. And we even created garage-style theater performances, which we did with our pals and friends in the neighborhood, sheets hung up like the curtain, etc. I don't know where we got all that creativity. I got my first insect sting when Laura and I were on some adventure walking through the nearby woods. It's one of those weird memories where I remember just going on and on about how much it hurt and how upset I was, and she was so comforting, as you probably all know Laura would be, even back then. Our houses were both well stocked in the 1960s with Barbie dolls and board games. We took ballet, acrobatics, tap dance together at the local dance school. And there it is. We haven't changed a bit. I love that picture. We loved our neon orange fringe Indian costumes worn for a recital and many times after that. And what's so fun is when she came back to see me 12, 14 years ago, she had that costume. And she gave it to me, and I was able to give my daughter that costume, and there is a picture somewhere, I don't think I shared it, but with my daughter wearing that costume and Laura and I posing like that. It was so much fun. It was so thoughtful of her. When Laura started lessons on the grand piano, I had to learn too, and eventually we loved the impressive sound of four hands playing duets together. Our older siblings had all the new music, and though through their records we were introduced to the likes of Elton John, ever heard of him? Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, the Beach Boys, and the Beatles, and the nice neighbor lady who lived next door, whom I'm guessing found Laura absolutely adorable, gave her a nice stash of her closet cast-offs for us to play dress-up with hats and gloves and heels and fancy dresses, beautifully matched. We watched our share of TV, too. The Beverly Hillbillies was a summer morning tradition, and one of our favorite afternoon shows was the original Dark Shadows vampire soap opera. And we reminisced about that just a few years ago when the Johnny Depp movie came out. I texted her and she texted me back immediately wishing that she was with me to watch that movie. It was really fun. There was one year back in the day when somehow we became huge fans of the Chicago Cubs. And it didn't last too long, but we watched almost every game through the whole season. Isn't that amazing? I guess that's a little tomboy in us. Sometimes running home to turn on the TV, as soon as our school bus dropped us off, we couldn't wait. Laura reminded me a few years back about the time we discovered my older sister's Nancy Drew Mysteries, a bunch of those books, I think some people remember. We picked a book up, sat down, and totally devoured these books in one stretch. That was my first time ever doing that, too. My first time skiing was with Laura. There's a theme here, so many firsts back in the day. She invited me to join her family for a day trip to an Illinois ski resort. That's right, Illinois has a few. Not great, but it was so much fun, and it was great to learn that our families have continued enjoying the sport in more mountainous terrain like Utah and Colorado. Idaho, too, probably. I have also fond memories of going with Laura's family on vacation to a Wisconsin lake house, and they had rented it for a week. I guess being the only girl among five siblings, she was allowed to bring a friend, lucky me. Through these stories and many more, I am so often reminded of the lasting impact of our time together in those years. I'm so deeply grateful that Laura reached out to me back in 2002 after she found me on our high school reunion directory. It was a 25th reunion. I'll never forget the day at work when Laura's first email arrived out of the blue, blast from the past, with kind words and appreciation for our childhood friendship. I laughed and cried at work, didn't get much done that day, and we continued our dialogue, and finally, a few months later, she arrived at my house with Dan and Skylar that time. And that image is still vivid in my mind of my childhood friend Laura stepping out of that car, and there she was. It was like we picked up where we left off. It was really beautiful. Her bright smile greeting me. We had such a fabulous visit. And the following year, she came to town again, this time with Dylan. And the three of us drove up to Wisconsin. It was a nice invitation to go visit her father for lunch. So that was so amazing to do all of that. And our reconnection has meant the world to me. It's like she unearthed treasures from our past. It's such a tremendous gift. I learned of Laura's illness last August. Sorry. And reached her by phone. Sorry. I know how to talk through tears. I do it all the time. And after that, so I reached her by phone, and after that, what turned out to be a lovely, though difficult, catch-up conversation on the phone. And when my twins went off to college last fall, I made a rare solo voyage, the first of what I thought would be many empty nester girlfriend trips out west, and I had a chance to come up and see her. And I am so thankful to you, Dan, for making that happen. I know it was a little complicated, and I had a wonderful time with your beautiful wife, my dear old friend, one more time. Too young, too soon, she's gone. It's impossible to fathom, and it'll take time to sort through these feelings of heartache, loss. Sorry. Okay. But Laura's love and her beautiful spirit will live on in each of us, and I take some comfort and knowing that she will always be a part of me, and she will always be in my heart. My hugs to all of you.
My name's Bonnie Sheppy. I have been a colleague, sweet mate, and friend of Laura's for 16 years. So I'll be talking about Laura as a therapist, colleague, and sweet mate, and friend. So everyone's been telling me to speak from my heart, and no one did that better than Laura. So I'm going to follow her lead here. I met Laura 16 years ago when I joined a very interesting group of therapists. Rather than individuals simply sharing a building with a suite, they had this compelling idea to create what they called an intentional community. As you can guess, Laura was at the heart of this creation. She was passionate about community and was at the heart of this creation. Laura held fast to this idea of community throughout the years and was a strong voice for that vision. She would keep it going when we would get off track, and that happened quite frequently to her dismay. So in preparing for today, our colleagues and I have been sharing our memories and stories of our much loved sweet mate, colleague, friend, and amazing therapist. I'm going to be sharing some of those stories. I'll start with two of my favorite stories of Laura. When I joined our group, I was transitioning from a career as a nurse to being a therapist, and I was experiencing lots of insecurities. Laura would say to me, "Bonnie, you are a great therapist." I would say, "Laura, how do you know that?" She would say, "I just know, Bonnie, I just know." That conversation happened over and over. And because I had such great respect and admiration for Laura, what choice did I have but to believe her? I just had to believe her. I can't tell you how supported I felt. Anytime I was struggling, she was always a soft place for me to fall. Her ability to be fully present with me so completely was amazing, absolutely amazing. I rarely have felt so truly seen and heard by anyone. I will forever be grateful, Laura, for that. Thank you. I had the rare opportunity to talk with many of Laura's clients when she had to take a medical leave. And I was the one who called them to inform them that she was taking this leave. I was able to see Laura, the therapist, through the eyes of many of her clients. A rare opportunity indeed. What I saw was how connected they were to her and how much they had been helped by her and what a wonderful person they thought she was. The outpouring of love and concern, respect and admiration was palpable. "Laura, you were a great therapist. I just know. I know." So now I'm going to read some stories from our colleagues that have known and loved Laura. Some of them were together with her for 20 years. So what I remember about Laura was her conviction to include everyone, to make sure everyone's needs were being addressed. She was passionate about that. When I walk around the suite, our office suite, I see Laura. Her attention to how an environment made you feel was amazing. Everything from the colors to the art to the placement of the furniture. I can only imagine her attention to such detail was reflected in her work with her clients, where her empathy and passion for caring for others was likely most evident. In my eyes, Laura was the heart of our community. She was often the most sensitive to what was really going on. At times, we would skate over the top of a quick business decision, and she would be the one who said, "Wait a minute," and then she would share her heart. Bring us all back to our hearts and the heart of the matter. One of the things that made my day was walking down the hall and seeing Laura's door open and her sitting there. I took that to mean that she was open to visitors. I usually had something on my mind, and Laura was always able to help me find the humorous side of whatever was going on. I usually left there with a smile and a chuckle. Laura's grace, elegance, and sense of humor were what attracted her to me. I miss my dear friend. Oh, I love this one. Laura had talked to me about this decision many times. We had looked at the pros and cons. It was a big decision. A life-changing decision in small and more subtly in big ways. One day she came to me and said, "I'm going to do it." And I knew immediately what she was referring to. We both know she could have a really tough 4 to 6 months with this. She would have to control the impulse to go back to the usual behavior. Behaviors that she had indulged in for years. Some people don't really ever make it through this, but I believed she could. Every time I saw her, I supported her decision. She was doing beautifully. And then came the day when it was accomplished. She could look at herself in the mirror and say, "I have beautiful silver hair." Laura supported me in doing mine, transition. Okay. One of my fondest memories was first coming into her office and seeing shelves of toys. She was silly and playful, one of the best forms of healing. And Laura was all about healing and connection. Both in the consult group and informally, when offering her wisdom, Laura made many suggestions that I used to improve life for my clients. I passed on some of her ideas to other therapists as well. In turn, various clients passed on Laura's ideas to their friends. In this way, Laura's wisdom has grown exponentially throughout our community. Laura's ideas and healing nature will continue on. When consulting with Laura on a case, I was struck by the combination of clinical expertise and deep compassion that Laura possessed. Then during a co-therapy session, I was in awe of the way Laura was able to impart psychoeducation without any hint of preaching or talking above the clients' heads. I was impressed and inspired by the way in which she was able to stay emotionally attuned to the clients while at the same time helping them to understand some rather esoteric facts about how the mind functions. I have been at a loss for words, so So I chose some from a little book, Salutations, Wit and Wisdom from Charlotte's Web, a little book that Laura put in our staff bathroom. This is a quote from that book. Charlotte said, "You've been my friend. That in itself is a tremendous thing. I wove my webs for you because I liked you. After all, what's a life all about anyway? We're born, we live a little while, we die. A spider's life can't help being something of a mess with all this trapping and eating flies. But helping you, perhaps I was trying to lift up my life a trifle. Heaven knows anyone's life can stand a little of that." This is also taken from that little book, revised. "Our dear Laura was brilliant, beautiful, and loyal to the end. She was in a class by herself. It's not often that someone comes along who is a true friend. We will always treasure her memory."
Hi, I'm Holly Morris, Dan's sister, and he asked me to say a few words about our relationship and Laura. When I think of Laura, it comes in a series of moments, moments that represent the loving, wise, delightful impact she had on this world. Dan and Laura were high school sweethearts, as you saw. At 19, they split up for a bit. A natural break for any two teenagers attending different colleges. As she was leaving our house that day, they broke up. She sought me out, sat me down on the gold shag carpet covered stairs, looked me in the eyes, and with tears in hers, told me she cared about me and would miss me. I was 10. It was a simple and extraordinary moment of acknowledgement, emotion, and respect toward a little girl. I'm sorry now that I never told her of its impact on me. It made a little girl exist. She was a young woman then, really a girl herself. But that gesture, I think, said a lot about the woman she would become and the kindness and respect that fueled her relationships. It was the first of many times she taught me about the power and possibility of emotional honesty, of simply saying something, of how much words matter. I was thrilled, we all were, when some 5 years later, Laura and Dan married. She became for me a big sister, a bestie, and as the decades would unfold, a role model. As a new member of the Borman-Morris clan, Laura had to roll with some messy punches, and it couldn't always have been easy. Then again, as a budding family therapist, she may have found us an interesting case study, if not a cautionary tale. There was another moment, the night she was in labor with her second baby, the 3-year-old Nicholas Dillon, was bouncing off the walls in their home in Kirkland. Dan was stressed out, trying to get Dillon to go to bed. Laura was in pain, labor pain, panting, getting ready to go to the hospital. This is the scenario in which a woman gets full license to rip into her frittering husband and tireless toddler. I'll never forget how she rose above the chaos, knowing, even in that state, the larger meaning of the moment. She brought everybody around her back to center, into the fold. "Bedtime doesn't matter, Dan," Laura said with kindness as she perched on the side of her chair. Dan softened, and Dillon calmed down and curled himself around her big belly, which would, in a matter of hours, deliver Skylar into the world. It was one of many times that Laura would take a deep breath and wrap a moment of intense difficulty in a blanket of grace and transform it. As much as I love my partner, Michael, I can honestly say I would not have married him if it weren't for Laura and Dan and their model of marriage as an inspired egalitarian institution. One that required work, of course, but held promise of such rich emotional, loving, even spiritual dividends. Laura's bond with Dan, a love affair of 4 decades, was about kindness, attention, devotion, and sometimes difficulty and conflict, which can be survived. It all lives together. Your brother, she used to say to me with a smile, in moments of both love and tension, often pouring a steaming cup of half-calf. Your brother. When asked, Laura generously supplied ACE-free therapy on matters of professional ambition, parenthood, and how to take yourself, how to take care of yourself in a world that will happily suck you dry if you let it. She knew this territory. She occasionally spun parables based on her therapy practice, but she never revealed client names. You're all safe here. Laura made people feel special, heard. She helped us all heal and grow. She gave great advice. When my baby was on the way, she helped with all the practical questions. Drugs or no drugs, sleep training, and my biggest concern, what if I have a boy? Laura, having grown up with her dad and 3 brothers and for much of the time without a mom, then having 2 sons of her own, navigated much of her life without another woman under the same roof. But she compensated for that by having so many good girlfriends, many of whom are here today. Only occasionally did Laura offer advice unsolicited, and when she did, it was somehow delivered in such a loving, compassionate little package, it went down easy. One time, she and I were passengers in a car. My mom, Jeannie, was driving. My then 4-year-old daughter was in the back seat with me and Laura. I started hassling my mom about her driving, backseat driving. My daughter watched. Laura, with her trademark delicacy and non-judgment, leaned over to me, glanced at my daughter, and quietly said, "That's going to come back and bite you someday, Holly." She didn't charge me a dime. Laura was a tremendous intentional parent, and it reminds me of the George Clinton quote, "Awesome power of the fully operational mothership." Dylan and Skylar had a mom who listened, attended, taught, and honored them, but she didn't throw her career or needs under the bus in the name of motherhood. Laura's spirit is much of why Dylan and Sky are the musical, political, individualistic, creative, loving, and loved young men they are. Young men smart enough to find extraordinary women like their mother to be with. Young men who can cook. Over the decades, Laura was my role model in ways and means of self-growth. I believe the older Laura got, the happier and healthier she became. And her final months of illness do not detract from this. After her diagnosis, Laura said, "This chapter of my life matters." And she spoke of the agency and even curiosity with which she planned to face her unpredictable future. She stayed true to that. There was a moment last year after Laura recovered from her initial stroke. We were moving boxes into their new house and paused to watch the last bits of a sunrise. "I am so lucky," she said with that magic, radiant smile about recovering from the incident. Then she grabbed a box and began setting up a new home. Laura faced hardship and overcame a lot in her life, but gratitude is what always rose to the top. She knew it all lived together. In the last days of her life, when words were hard to come by, here were some of hers. "Super nice. I love you. Thank you. Yes. Yummy." Until the end, she felt grateful and loved. Laura and Dan were human and heroic together as they crossed the finish line. In that, they delivered their final lessons as a couple to all of us. They moved through the difficult moments and months of the past year with uncanny grace. I'm confident we will miss Laura horribly in the years to come, and I'm equally confident her remarkable spirit will live on. Because we're so sad right now and Laura is gone so young, it may feel hard to celebrate her life. But we should celebrate because hers was a well-lived, conscious, and true life, an adventure she shared with so many of us, and the one that we all learned so much from. I will miss flying kites with Laura. I will miss simply being in the room as she did crafts with my daughter, prepared a Thanksgiving feast with Dan, talked Buddhism with my husband, accepted my mother as her own. I will miss singing Skylar's songs with her and hearing of Dylan's passions. I will miss our long walks, short runs, and eating chocolate together. I will miss the free therapy. In her work and with her loved ones, Laura, with generosity, humility, joy, and quiet strength, went about the business of becoming her best self and changing lives. I know Laura's memory and many gifts will continue to transform us all.
As you've already seen from the pictures, Dan and Laura traveled the world together and made many friends. Now we're going to hear from two of those friends from New Zealand, Mike and Sharon Tawana.
Kia ora, everyone. My name is Mike Tomoana. Laura knew me as Tux. Beside me, I have my wife, Sharon, and my daughter, Gabrielle. We are all grateful for the opportunity to show our love and respect for Laura today, across the ocean and far away here in New Zealand. As you can see by the uniform, I'm a pilot with Air New Zealand. We met Laura several years ago as a result of Dan coming down under to fly the 737 with us. I was involved in much of Dan's flying and we became good friends. As I got to know him, I learned about a great love in his life. I came to know Dan as a deep thinker who was sincere, compassionate, and who shared his world with a kindred spirit in Laura. My family and I met Laura about a year after Dan finished his work in New Zealand, when he brought his family to visit our corner of the world that had made an impact on him. We had the pleasure of meeting Jeannie, Nick, and Leonard, and eventually Skylar, who managed to create his own headlining arrival by missing his flight from LA and turning up 24 hours late. I'm sure this will be no surprise to some of you. He made up for it in style, though, entertaining us all into the small hours, as he does so well. We were able to share some of my ancestral indigenous Māori traditions with Dan and Laura, which loosely translates to meaning we found some willing and innocent participants to do all the hard work preparing and cooking a hāngi, or earth oven meal, while I looked on and supervised. This was a wonderful experience for us, and as I got to know Laura, a few things fell into place for me about these two special people. Laura was crystal clear about what her man's passion was and how deeply he felt about it. I sensed that she also felt his anguish as deeply when he faced the difficult challenges in his life. I know that she would champion for his cause with strength and determination, and no doubt for all those that she loved deeply. I marveled at her capacity for aroha, which means love in my native Māori language. My family and I could see how much Laura was such a special soul. I'm sure that much of what I've expressed today has already been spoken about Laura, and as my family and I mourn with you, I would like to offer two Māori proverbs that resonate with us. My friend Dano, you have known a rare and special aroha in your life, as has your whānau, which means family, and your friends. Your Laura has also known the aroha of a good man, wonderful whānau, and lifelong friends. She has found peace. In my home province of Ngāti Kahungunu, we say, Ma te huruhuru te manu karere. With feathers, a bird can fly. Dano, my dear friend, you have been, along with your family and your friends, the feathers in Laura's time here that have given her the freedom to fly on this earth and now to heaven. In closing, I would like to share something that I shared with Dan that resonates with the essence of Laura. It is a question for the ages, and the answer captures much of the Laura we know and love. He aha te mea nui o te ao. What is the most important thing in this world? He tangata, he tangata, he tangata. It is people, it is people, it is people.
Last summer then, when Laura was living with her cancer, Skylar came up to visit many times and offer his own kind of therapy. This is then a song written for his mother called Cry. I suppose years from now, we'll be able to conjure up images of her. Maybe when we see a beautiful garden rose, or a young mother walking down the road with her two boys, or laughter on a mountain trail. But when we honor her, it will be with a special facility to hear and feel what other people are feeling around us. Because to make the point one last time, in Laura's world, no one is left out, ever. This space is set up now to continue to remember her and to fellowship with each other. So here are some final things to share. If you haven't signed the guest book in the entry, please do. And there are also 6 journals, and you are invited to write any story, any recollection, or messages to the family in one of these. And then brunch will be next. There's a buffet back in the main room, and then also upstairs on the second floor. And the 2 stairways are either on your left or back near the entry door. The event concludes here at the Schoolhouse at 1, and so if you'd like to have more time to visit, please do. Laura's friend and quilting buddy, Michelle, has offered her home. And this is only a few minutes away from here, and the address is in your program, and also a map on the table in the entry. So we'll conclude now with one last collection of photos. Thank you so much for coming and honoring our dear Laura.
This old house is falling down around my ear. I'm drowning in a river of my tears. When all my will is gone, you hold me sway. I'm living for the night with Steve.